Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Bees Deluxe.
Song is called Letter from Jail. Thank you. send it to you. Every letter begins with each day is the same. I write on the wall, write on the floor, write on a piece of paper, wrap it up and send it to you. This is a letter from Jane, and I send it to you.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Talkin' Tunes. I am your host, Frank Walsh. Thanks for tuning in today. As you can see, the band that you just heard are unbelievable, and you are going to be in for a treat because you are going to hear some more. These folks are known all over New England. They played in many great venues. They play a little bit of different music that we're used to having on here, but as you can see, regardless of the differences, it is something that you are going to tap your toes to. So it gives great pleasure to introduce you to Bees Deluxe. And I am going to let this lovely lady introduce the band. Go ahead, Carol.
Thank you, Frank. I'm Carol Band. I play keyboards and harmonica. This is Paul Giovanni. He's the drummer. Conrad War, who is the front man, guitar and vocals. And Jim Gilday, who's on bass.
Well, I'm glad that they put the queen of the group in front of here.
Queen bee.
They expect you to do all the talking. So I'm going to forget these guys and I'm going to talk just to you. Because I heard that you are such a conversationalist and you just love being on camera.
I've got all the dirt.
I'm kidding. Well, first of all, thanks a lot for coming on, guys.
Thanks for having us.
That first song that you played off, there's no better way to kick off the show than with a song like that. But let's give the folks at home a little bit of history about you guys. How you guys got together. Maybe talk a little bit about your individual backgrounds of how you come up in music. And Conrad, you're the front guy, so why don't you kick it off?
So I was drinking in a bar with a friend of mine named Maurice.
You're of age, I hope.
I was old enough to drink.
Okay.
And so was Maurice. And he said, "That guy on stage there is not as good as you." And I went, "What do you mean?" He says, "I'm booking you." I go, "I don't have a band." He says, "I'll sing, you play." So we had a band within that week. Now, Maurice has had to skip town since then for reasons I won't go into now.
Oh, come on, go into them. Nobody watches this show.
The police won't get after us. And I go, "Well, we can't be called that anymore." So I had to come up with a name in 12 hours. So that's why we're called Bees Deluxe.
Nice. Now, how long ago was that?
At least 10 years ago.
Really? And I'm sure that you've had a lot of evolutions of the band since then?
It incarnations. There's a Spinal Tap flavor to the band sometimes.
Right.
We had a keyboard player who quit us to go and play with Greg Allman. So I couldn't drag him back from that.
That wasn't Bruce Mattson, was it?
Yeah.
Bruce has been on the show. I filmed him a number of times.
Bruce was in the band, but he said, "I'm going to play with Greg Allman." I went, "See ya."
Big fingers to Phil.
Oh, absolutely.
But then we found Carol. She came to a jam at Johnny D's when it was going.
One of the best clubs around.
It was a good place.
Yeah.
And we found him because we were looking for...
a drummer.
Yeah, but what was the name of the drummer we were looking
for? Bernard Purdy.
Bernie Purdy.
So he wasn't available.
And Paul knew who he was.
He used code in the ad.
Really?
Code in the ad. Yeah. I knew who he was talking about.
Now, what is that something you could chat about, that code, or is this some secret thing?
He put an ad on Facebook, you know, looking for Bernard Purdy, who, as we all know, is one of the most famous drummers in all genre ever. So I'm a big Purdy fan.
Okay.
So I said, oh, that's kind of weird. Let's see what this guy's about. So I answered it as if I was Bernard Purdy.
Ah, I gotcha.
So he said, all right.
And it kind of weeded out, you know, all the sort
everyone
of
else, yeah.
baseline of drummers yeah. who just played Lynyrd Skynyrd.
So wow.
So he went to go check him out at Toad, which I think is back again. Is Toad open again? And insisted I join the band.
And cool. Paul found Jim under a rock in Western.
Yep. it was a lucky find.
And everybody sings. Except Paul won't let us put a mic on him.
No.
And why is that?
But he actually can sing.
But he can.
I've heard him.
I can sing.
Yeah. Why is that?
I don't want everyone else to feel.
Yeah, you know, why put, you know, yeah. Pavarotti with the...
They work so hard.
Yeah, Pavarotti with the choir, right?
You know? Exactly.
That's cool. Now, as far as, you know, your music go, how did you develop the style of music that you have? Because you're what, kind of a acid rock? Kind of, how would you describe your music? I mean, you're a little melange of everything. Acid rock, how would you categorize yourself?
We call it acid blues.
Acid blues.
Yeah, and the repertoire is built on the idea of don't play The Thrill Is Gone and don't play Giant Steps, because they're two extremes that are either overdone or shouldn't be done at all.
Okay.
So we're right in the middle, and we try to pick tunes that are A, fabulous and worth exploring, and B, that not everybody is playing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You play Free Bird, you know, since you're talking about Purdy?
No, we don't play Free Bird. Even a request.
But we could.
We could. Well, Joe and I do in a different band. But yeah.
Now, as far as, you know, some of the, you know, the music that you play, I mean, you know, some of the stuff today was familiar and some was not familiar. How do you go about selecting your songs? You do it collectively, or do you have an idea and say, hey, listen, let's try this, let's put this together? How do you come up with your, you know, your sets and keeping yourself evolving into the music?
It's usually my fault.
The other blame? Yes.
I'll bring a tune into the room and everybody will go, we don't want to play it. Oh yeah, let's play that and let's twist it.
But it's often fluid, like when we were playing at Madame's Organ and the house music was playing Chain of Fools, and we started
the
noodling.
Soundman. The soundman was checking the PA by playing Chain of Fools.
And we started sort of playing along with it. It's only got one chord. But we started sort of playing along with it, and then we said, hey, maybe we should do this song.
Wow.
So we do.
Well, now, do you try to incorporate songs that would include, like, you know, you're multi-instrumental, you play the keys, you play the harmonica.
I'll say, I think we need a harmonica solo in all of the songs that we do.
Okay. Yeah. I don't think I've heard Hail Mary with a Silent Night with a harmonica.
No,
you know,
it could happen.
You could probably do it.
Yeah.
Probably do it.
Absolutely.
Now, as far as, you know, individually, where were you playing? Let's kind of go around the horn here. When you came up and, you know, you started playing... When?
I started playing in college, and I played in a kind of surf, Cape Cod, Happy Hour cover band all through the 80s.
Really?
But then, you know, life came along, family, kids, job.
Sure.
Stopped playing, and then I kind of got back into music again and started playing some cover bands and met this guy right here, the drummer, Paul. And I said, wow, this guy is great. I want to play with him as much as I can. And he said, well, you know, this guy I play with, Bees Deluxe. And I said, yeah, I've seen him around. He says, well, you should just send him an email and see if he'll accept you. And
cool.
So I got an audition and managed to survive that, apparently.
Now, do you bounce around, too? Do you do freelancing with other bands? Like
Paul and I
just
freelance around here and there. But
you bounce around a little
bit? The Bees is a special thing. It's a very unique kind of music. Mm-hmm. I have music friends that say, what's it like? And I say, well, it's the Bees. I can't even describe it. It's like it's Hendrix sometimes. It's blues sometimes. It's just... It is what it is. You have to just see the band. I can't really...
Now, what did you say with Tom? I think when we were initially talking, you had said something like, "When if so-and-so and so-and-so had a baby, we would be them." Do you remember who...
Not Carol and Connor, though.
No. No, you were comparing something like about your music. You would say, if so-and-so and so-and-so had a baby, it would be our music.
In my mind, it's Bjork and Buddy Guy.
Okay.
And we have a song to that effect.
Bjork and Buddy Guy?
Yes,
it's called Imaginary Conversation Between Bjork and Buddy Guy.
Wow, that's cool.
Yeah.
Now, what about you? What about your background coming up?
Well, when I was a kid, I had an American girlfriend who slipped me an album compilation that had J.B. Lenoir and Elmore James and B.B. King on it. And I went, this is great. And a band came to school to play, and they lost their bass player on the way. And so they said, It was like a high school prom.
Yep.
Can anybody play? And I went, yeah, I can play. I never played a note before in my life. And I got hooked. I go, this is great. Look, the windows are shaking.
Right. Now, with that accent, you're from where?
From London, originally.
Oh, I was going to say Czechoslovakia, but you stepped on my... No, from London. Yeah. So you were back in the Beatles days, right?
After that. Okay. I toured with Joe Jackson and the Specials and the Selector and the Body Snatchers and Two-Tone era.
Right. Now, I know that, you know, the British Invasion was, you know, pretty big during, what, 60s into the 70s. Were you involved in that? Were you playing all the time? Were you?
No, that's a little older than me.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah. So, for instance, I've turned down rhythm guitar, keyboard player job in the Pretenders.
Okay.
Because I thought, they're not going anywhere. They're playing King's covers.
Wow.
But the good news is I'm still alive. Because if I joined them, I'd be dead now.
Right. That's true. That's true. Now, how long, you know, were you over there and then when you decided to come over here?
I think I've been here about 25 years. I'm 25, somewhere between 25 and 30. I moved to New York and I started playing in CBGBs. Okay. So I used the Village Voice. I got a bass player and a drummer. And I played the audition night on Monday. And Hilly liked us and said, come back on Tuesday and we'll pay you $20.
Wow.
And then he liked us on Tuesday and we gravitated up to playing opening for Living Color on Saturday for $20.
Now, how easy or difficult was it to make that transition, you know, coming over here, getting settled, breaking into the music scene?
They drive on the other side of the road, you know.
That's true.
It's totally
different.
Still
figuring that out. I
think in England, especially at that time, music was about fashion. It was about clothing and attitude and how smart you could be in the press. Whereas when you go to New York, it's like, how good are you? Can you play?
Wow. Now, where did you say you were in the Village? Were you in the Village?
I went around. I lived in a place called Tribeca.
Oh, Tribeca, sure.
I had an illegal sublet. And I would go
say
to the
mud club
my
for microphone.
Drinks.
Say that again slowly into my microphone. Illegal.
So I only found out recently that you were supposed to pay to get in the mud club.
Really?
But I used to go in there. That was my local for a pint.
Right. Now, who'd you bump into around those places? Yeah, I'm sure you played, bumped into a lot of big names and famous faces back then.
A little bit, yeah. I got into a fight with Iggy Pop a couple of times.
Really?
Yeah.
He speaks well of you.
A couple times.
He's scared of me.
A couple times.
Cool, cool. I know. See, he's kind of putting the period at the end of that sentence, like move on. I have to give a big shout out while you were talking there. I have a friend of mine, Debbie Rolka Gillis. I don't know if your friend's on Facebook, but she is a huge fan of men with British accents. And I told her that you were going to be on the show today, and she's been a big follower of you, and she's told me to say hello to Conrad.
Hello.
That was my shameless plug for my friend. It was funny, just as a quick aside, I had a friend of mine, we were doing my sports show, and my friend had a friend who was visiting here from England. So at the end of the sports show, we got up in front of the green light, up in front of the green screen, and he sang a little song for her in his British accent. But she really loves the British accent. But anyway, that was a quick aside. Shameless plug. Your turn.
My turn.
Yeah.
So, I'm from Connecticut. And in high school, I had a buddy of mine that was getting some gigs around town. I was in the high school band, and he pulled me out of that. So I started playing in high school. That led me to UConn. I went to UConn for music education for a year, then up to Berkeley.
They had a lousy basketball team, didn't they? Especially the girls' basketball team.
I was there in 84. They were just starting in the 80s. Just starting. Not what it is today.
Oh, my God.
Then I ended up at Berkeley in Boston. I just kind of started playing around in various bands. In the 90s, I was in a couple bands that were doing pretty well, touring out on the original circuit. And then like Life and Kids came along.
Sure.
And I kept doing the cover band thing. Just to stay local. And really, this is my first venture out of that. I've been with him almost 7 years.
How long were
now.
You up here out of Connecticut?
Because I came up in 86.
Oh, good. So Connecticut has come a long way as far as music. There's some nice venues down there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
A lot of great venues.
Hartford area,
come
New
down,
Haven
yeah.
area, used to, you know, has yeah. come up a little bit too. Manchester area actually has some blues clubs. I've been trying to sniff around.
You guys strike me as a band that would play in the Wolf Den. You guys ever play in a Wolf Den down there?
At the Foxwoods?
At Mohegan?
Or Mohegan? Yeah. No, we haven't. But
you guys would be a great band to play at Mohegan. You should check into that at the Wolf Den. They would love your kind of music.
We tour from Rockland, Maine, all the way down to Miami.
Really?
Yeah, and Paul is a touring monster because He's made of concrete, and he can sleep on the floor.
Really?
Yeah. And he drives fast.
You're a fast driver?
We have a faster jump. My sub is faster.
Slightly faster.
Slightly faster.
Well, we'll have a showdown in the driveway, you know, so you can get from one end to the other the quickest. And your turn, young lady.
My story's short. I'm also from Connecticut.
Really?
I played piano.
Did you know each other from back then?
We didn't.
No.
It's a big state.
We live close every now and then.
Yeah. We could have known each other.
Yeah.
I was a piano player since I was a kid.
Really?
I was the substitute organist. I would come in and play the piano when the organist was out at church.
Wow.
So I have the church background. And then I dropped all things. I played in coffee houses and things like that. And then I started studying jazz when I came to Boston, and I was more sort of a solo piano jazz kind of thing, and I played with a little ensemble, met Conrad, and he proselytized me into the blues.
Proselytize.
That sounds bad.
Gonna have to look that up.
But it isn't.
I was an English teacher, so I know what that means. Do you ever play any of the jazz clubs, like play Wally's Paul's Mall or Scullers?
I was a waitress at Paul's Mall.
Really?
Yeah.
So you're the one.
Yeah. but yes, Ryle's.
Wow, you played all those. Yeah, I used to go there all the time. I used to have my own table at Scullers. They have phenomenal jazz.
Yeah, well, they get national acts.
And now what's great to hear is that you probably know about Jimmy's up in New Hampshire.
Yes.
You know, I guess they just announced that they're having a huge jazz resurgence, and they're going to be bringing in some top shelf names.
Yeah, it's a big,
pretty much throughout 23.
It's a big venue.
Good.
It is a big venue, yeah. But I think maybe we can take a little bit of break, and instead of talk about our music here, I think it's time that maybe we can let the folks at home listen a little more to it, okay? All right, so folks, sit back, buckle up, and we will be back in a couple of minutes.
Send it to you. Every letter begins with each day is the same. I write on the wall, write on the floor, write on a piece of paper, wrap it up and send it to you. This is a letter from Jane. And I send it to you. I don't know the way to so find you, but I should be there. Because I write on the wall, write on the floor, write on a piece of paper, wrap it up and send it to you.
Here's a song we wrote called Flat Earth Conspiracy.
The world is flat. We can no lie. If you don't believe me, look in the sky. It's not blue.
Another song what we wrote called Beer. Song written by Fenton Robinson, not Buzz Scaggs. Thank you.
Thank you. Said it was just a shack. Maybe you have a children. Now you want to give a thank you.
having us. That was Bees Deluxe.
Wow, guys, that was, once again, that was pretty impressive. I told you that you would enjoy what you hear. So let's talk a little bit about some of your influences. I know you know you've got a wide variety of backgrounds, and let's kind of go around the horn. We'll start this time about some of your influences and, you know, how you got the chops that you have and who may have influenced you along the way to play the way you play.
Start with me?
Yeah.
Well, early on, I was a child of the 70s, and so
You're
I was...
born in a hospital because you wanted to be near your mother?
Right, exactly. But I was, of course, influenced by the, sort of the singer-songwriter females like Carol King
Carol
and Joni
King.
Mitchell and Laura Nero, and
right.
those harmonies that they're all so different.
Right,
they bring.
Right.
So those influenced me early on, and then I had a job as a newspaper reporter, and I did a story where I went to see Mary Lou Williams and Dizzy Gillespie play, and she knocked my socks off.
I don't know her.
You don't know her?
Mary Lou Williams?
Yeah. Oh, she's one of the old greats.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I didn't mean it.
And
I'll call her tonight.
Yeah, yeah.
And apologize.
And so that then I started listening to Billie Holiday and, you know, all those great blues women.
Yeah.
And now I find some inspiration in that Japanese gal.
Keiko Matsui.
No.
Do you know Keiko?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, I met Keiko and her husband.
No, Harami Uhara.
Yeah.
Who is just incredible. So much energy and such a, she reminds me, she's like Bees Deluxe.
Really?
Impersonated in one body because she plays all different styles, everything from classical to electronic to, yeah, she's just a ball of energy and fantastic musician.
Cool. And what about you, young man?
I like the young man. Well,
called sucking up to your guest.
I'd be remiss without mentioning Kiss, 56. So when I grew up, you know, they were the, not the Beatles, but they got a lot of kids into music. So I was into, but quickly.
You were in the heavy metal, the heavy stuff?
Yeah, I was, Van Halen was about as heavy as I got in the 80s. But once I got into the jazz and Latin and sort of bluesy and other stuff, I started gravitating more towards the Bernard Purdy's or like the Steve Gadd's or the Jeff Porcaro's.
Okay.
More the studio, the guys that were playing everything, you notice their names on rock, pop, jazz, fusion.
Right.
Steve Smith from Journey is an amazing jazz drummer.
Okay.
So those guys, Terry Bozzio, I could probably keep going here. But I was into the Bonham and the Charlie Watts and all that too, the groove-oriented stuff.
Neil Peart, who's Peart with?
Neil Peart, rest in peace, died a couple of years ago, was with Rush.
Rush.
And he's another guy that got a lot of kids in the 80s into
a lot
drumming.
Of people, right.
Whether you went that way or not, it kind of got you interested, you know. So Stuart Copeland, the way he would, from the Police, with the ethnic reggae, you know, Middle Eastern stuff. So yeah, I was into that more than just slogging ahead with
Now I've
Bon
asked
Jovi
a lot of people the differences between you know, some people can be rock drummers, they can't be a blues drummer, or they can't be a jazz drummer. How easy or difficult is it to make that transition when you're going from, let's say, Bees Deluxe and then you go into playing jazz? Is that an easy transition or
I consider Bees almost a jazzy band, you know, you can improv, you can sort of, I think you hear the dynamics that we do, so within that.
Because jazz is more improv, most of the jazz and drumming is more improv, whereas the other is more scripted.
More scripted, and in jazz, of course, you're switching, you know, it's more about the hi-hat and the ride cymbal.
Okay.
less about
I love the techie talk.
Kick and snare, but that's a techie talk thing right there, so that's a switch, though. you can always tell a rock drummer who's playing jazz who hasn't a lot of experience, because he's wailing the two and
all
four.
All over the place, right.
And you can also tell a jazz guy who's playing rock who's not used to it, because everything's kind of light and cymbally.
Yeah.
So, but the guys I mentioned seem to figure it all out.
Yeah, one of my favorite jazz drummers was Alphonse Mouzon.
Oh, sure. He does it all too, yeah.
I love Alphonse.
Mm-hmm. Producer, you know, too. Great
is
producer.
He still
too.
Is he still around? Is he still alive? Oh, yeah. I know I kind of lost touch with him. I saw him, like I say, I was a staple at Sculler's. So
Big
been
few,
there,
yeah.
seen them all, and, you know, he was phenomenal.
Yep, still is. No, still is.
Still?
He produces a lot too. Yeah.
I have to check that out.
Yep.
What about you, sir? You already talked a little bit about, but pick up the ball a little bit.
I think that best musical week of my life was going to see Mongo Santa Maria at Ronnie Scott's right. every night for a week.
Wow.
And it got, after the third night, he invited me backstage.
Wow.
And they were playing music that I hadn't heard before, which was, it's now a common thing, Latin American funk.
Great.
But that was just wonderful. Probably the best concert I ever saw was Stevie Wonder. It was at the Rainbow, and they were doing a double header. He was playing a show and then another show that night.
Wow.
So they tried to clear the room, but we'd hide in the bathroom with our feet up to stay for the second one. And the second set, he came out and he played drums for 15 minutes.
Wow.
And it was just like the lightning hit you. That was so good.
That's one I've missed. I would have loved to have seen him. I know he was here a few years ago, and I couldn't get there. That's one I would really love. I grew up with that stuff. I grew up Motown, Stevie. I grew up with all that. So, yeah. So, but that was a drum. He was playing the drums, though. What about your guitar chops?
I try not to listen to other guitar players.
Really?
Because most of them are way better than me, so they'll just depress me. And the ones that aren't better than me, why should I listen to them? So I like to listen to drums. I like to listen.
Can you learn from the people who are better than you?
No, it's too good. It's too hard. So for instance, my favorite
wimp. You need a new front man. A wimp.
I like Paul Desmond. I like Trelo Gyrtu. I like people who are playing music that's got enormous soul and integrity, but it's not. I'm not trying to do what they do. So that's why I enjoy listening to them.
So who would you listen to if I went out and, you know, pulled out a CD or went to your home and looked at some records? Who would you put on your CD and
right
would
you now listen to? I'm listening to Spectrum by Billy Cobham.
Okay.
Yeah, that's in the car, and at home I'm listening to King Sonny Ade.
Cool. That's a little change of pace there.
Not really, because they're funk oriented. You know, they want you to move when you hear the music,
mm-hmm.
and that's what kills me. That's what works.
Interesting. What about you?
I don't know. I like Paul. I grew up listening to, you know, Kiss as a little kid, you know, and then kind of moved on from there. Went through my Rolling Stones phase, Led Zeppelin phase. You know, everyone goes through these phases. I like it all. I like all kinds of music. I like to listen to reggae music. I like to listen to country sometimes.
Who's your favorite bass player? Who do you listen to for bass players?
They're all so good. I mean, like, they're all great. Jamerson, you know, all those guys, the Motown guys. Anyone that plays with the groove is great.
I was telling a story yesterday, I'll give a quick repeat, is that one of the highlights of being over at Scullers was that, you're familiar with Wayman Tisdale?
Yeah.
The basketball player?
Mm-hmm.
He was an all-pro basketball player, and he took up bass playing, took up the bass. And I saw him at Scullers, and you didn't know whether he was a basketball player who played bass or a bass player who played basketball.
No kidding.
He was enormous. He was like 6'10", 6'11". His hands were like this.
Yeah.
And he was quiet and humble, and he would get over that bass. And it, like I say, his hands were giant, and he would just do his thing.
Having big hands helps on the bass.
It was magic. It was magic, and unfortunately, he passed way too young. And but I met him, he actually gave me an autographed pair of his sneakers.
Wow.
Exactly. Exactly. They were like size 14.
Yeah, there's a coach in the NBA now that plays jazz keyboard.
That's
that
right.
Does gigs when he comes into town.
Well, there are baseball players who do that.
Well, Bernie Williams is a great
Bernie Williams is a great player.
Jazz guy.
And, who's the writer? Peter Gammons.
Oh, does he play as well?
Yeah, right? Gammons plays.
He has cool music.
Yeah. Kind of an all-star band, and well, Ernie Bach, you know, Ernie Bach has a phenomenal, phenomenal band,
mm-hmm.
you know. But that's interesting. Now, we know where your music is. Where do you plan on taking it? What do you see in your future for Bees Deluxe? You know.
Oh.
You take that one.
I'm not the head man. I'm not driving the van. But
when in doubt, go to you.
I think we'd like to do more of the same. And
more shows.
Of the same. More shows,
yeah.
More festivals. We'd like to break some new ground. Where would we like to play that we haven't played? Perhaps at the Wolf Den.
Have you played with John Hall? You know John Hall?
Yes, he booked us for the Marshfield Fair one summer.
Yeah, you played
so
there.
And like
he has another
one.
Series now down in Plymouth at the John Alden.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you know, he does shows down there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but we'd love to do that.
So you want to diversify. I know you play all over the country. You know, traveling, is that an issue for you? You know, if somebody called you up and wanted to book you down in Florida, would you?
We go there.
Would you all be able to do that?
Yeah, and we all drive.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So we did last, when was Blues Blast at the Ranch?
March.
We drove down to Florida for that. And we'll pick up gigs on the way down and on the way back up again.
Right.
To make it pay for gas.
Yeah. Barely.
Mm. What about playing in Europe, playing overseas? I mean, so many people that that we all know, they go to Lucerne, they're playing, you know Sax Gordon, who seems to be all over the world, yeah. You know, Jurassic that we had talked about earlier, and all these people, they're traveling all over the world. You know, would you do that, or could you do that, or why haven't you done that? Make a question out of that.
It's hard to book. I think we'd have to go through an agency, and we haven't found an agency we like yet.
Really? So you do everything yourself? You do all your own bookings?
Yeah.
All your own places? You?
Yes.
And you do good phone, right?
Yeah, I do.
Hi. I'm from Bees Deluxe.
We're driving to New York, and I think she made probably 40 calls in a row.
Yeah. Although sometimes we have to sit Conrad with his pretty voice onto people.
Right.
Especially if it's a woman on the other end.
Yeah. One other quick thing while it's in my head. How did the last couple of years with COVID affect you guys? A lot of people took a beating on that. And that really slow you guys down, or, you know?
Can I answer
You think
that?
So? You answer, because I think not.
Oh, come on. It was brutal.
Yeah. We got a couple of yeses. I didn't know whether it was a good yes or a bad yes.
When it broke in March, we were the last band to play
at Toad that night.
At Toad.
Yeah.
And everybody was getting out of town. They were like, something big is coming, and we are out of here.
Yeah.
And we were supposed to be going to Maine to play at the Grey Owl. The next day.
Right.
That's Paul Benjamin's place?
Paul Benjamin's place.
Yeah, Paul's place, right?
Yeah. And we're loading up the car, and the phone rang, and it was him. I kept saying, please, please cancel. Let's cancel this. Let's cancel. And finally, the phone rang, and they canceled. And then I thought, okay, well, you know, we'll be back in a couple of weeks. We'll be back in a couple of months.
Yeah, we'll be back in a couple of years.
We had a really full schedule. We had all kinds. Yeah.
I think we only ended up doing like 20 gigs that year.
Yeah, we had, we had stuff booked, and it all just went away.
Well, we had the City Wineries.
Yeah, we opened City Winery wearing masks, playing instrumentals. Yeah.
That's a nice room. That's a nice room. Now, have you guys played the Next Page? Have you with Eddie Page?
No.
No? For some reason, I thought that. Players at all? Did you play down in Players?
No.
Nope.
No, these are places you should check out.
Yeah.
You should check these places out.
We really like playing Madam's Organ in Washington, D.C.
Okay.
Have you ever been there?
No.
It's in Adams Morgan, so it's called Madam's Organ.
Really?
And it's four floors, and there's a chill bar and a snooker bar and a DJ, and then the main floor is the stage, and it is packed. You couldn't put a toothpick in there when we're playing.
Till 3
and we play from 10 in the evening till 2 in the morning.
Wow.
And it's just a riot. It's like playing Woodstock.
Wow.
It's
That's
hilarious.
Awesome. That's awesome.
It's a fun place.
Yeah, it's tough for me to get out of state. I'm, I'm on house arrest and I got the GPS, so I'm limited to Massachusetts. No. But anything else that we haven't covered that you think we should cover, and then we're going to let people know how they can get a hold of you and find your music, and if anybody wants to book you, we'll do all that. But anything else you might want to talk about or bring up that we may not have covered that you would like the people to
know? We've got an album in the can that we're still mixing.
Okay.
So we hope in the spring we'll have a new album of all originals out.
Okay.
And I think we'd like to gravitate more. We'd like to play Chicago. We haven't done that yet. We've basically done the East Coast and as far west as Cleveland.
Okay.
So I think we'd like to spread a little bit more. It's funny because when you go to a town where you've never been before and they've never heard of you, and you play in a room where they have decent music, they go ape.
Right, right.
You know, whereas when you play in your hometown, you know everybody in the room, and they're somewhat restrained. They've come to listen and have a glass of wine. But as I say, when you go to a club out of town and they hear what we're doing, they go crazy. And that's a lot of fun to play to that kind of an audience.
Awesome. Where can people get a hold of you?
Well, we're on the interweb.
The interweb.
Yeah, www.beesdeluxe.com. We're on Facebook, Bees Deluxe.
Yeah.
Spotify, YouTube.
SoundCloud, Deezer, Napster.
All of the media.
Yeah.
All
the local media. Good. One other thing before I go, normally I'll ask one person, it's a little tricky, but I'm going to ask this question because this should be easy to all four of you. You know, I haven't done this before, but I'll throw it out. Usually, like I say, I'll do it to one, okay? I'm going to give you all a hammer and a chisel, and we got Mount Rushmore up there. Who are you going to put on there, on your Mount Rushmore?
Well, I think I'd
just
have
one.
Just one?
Yeah.
Okay, Bill Evans.
Bill Evans.
I'm going to go Elvis Presley.
Elvis, good choice.
The Dalai Lama.
That's a serious one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I'm going to put a bass player up there, James Chamberson.
Okay.
Right. Okay, there has to be
that was too easy.
There has to be a woman up there.
That was too easy. You know, totally people.
Who would you put there?
Oh, my God. I'd have to go. If I had four of them, I'd have to probably put, top of my head, I'd have to put James Brown, B.B. King, Muddy Waters, and who else? If there was an extra one, I'd put Frank Sinatra and Barbara Streisand.
I was going to do Frank.
Sinatra and Streisand, I think. You know, best male vocalist, best female vocalist.
Yeah.
You know.
The classics.
It'd be hard to convince me otherwise. Linda Etter would be, like, if I kept on going, if you know Linda Etter, if you close your eyes, you'd think you'd be listening to Barbara Streisand and Celine Dion all in the same package. She's beautiful, and she's got a voice that'll make you cry. Linda Etter, she's Broadway. She was in the play Jekyll and Hyde, where she cut her teeth, and then she's just been all over the world. But guys and gals, it's been a blast today. I hope you had some fun.
Yeah,
it's
great.
Thanks for having us.
Hope you had some fun.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah,
you're
thanks.
Welcome. Now, folks, you know, as I always say, these folks go out and they play, and they wouldn't be able to play unless you at home supported them. So make sure that you get out and support these musicians. Go to the clubs, go to the bars, go to the festivals. They're there for you. So make sure that you do that. And we wouldn't be able to do the show without all the people who are behind the scenes, you know. First of all, we have a sitting audience today. We have George Carr, we have Bob Mosier, and we have Bob Taccio, who are nicely enough to come in here and cheer you guys on. And we have Luke and Kevin and Kevin in the booth, and our director, Anya. Want to thank you for allowing me to do this and have such wonderful guests as this. So again, thank you all.
Thanks, Frank.
And for you folks at home, as always, tune in and tune on.
Thank you, everybody at home.